Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy, and I'm finally joined because we've had a hell of a week trying to get this interview going between internet connections and laptops and updates and everything in between. I'm here for some good vibes, though. I'm joined by Luke Kyro this week. Welcome to the show.
Thanks a lot, Billy. No, it's been a nightmare getting on, but we're here now, and I'm really looking forward to it. So, thanks for having me on.
Excellent. Well, I mean, were you like? I think I asked you to when I started doing like I think the 10 questions with whoever roundabout. It must be years ago now, and you're one that I did contact, and you're like, no, I'm okay. I think it was because you were like really fresh, and you really didn't have much you wanted to speak about at that point.
You're literally bang on the money, because it was like, I think it was just nothing in sure that, because I've never said yes to anything. This is like the first kind of podcast thing I've done, but like with that, it was so early on. I was like, I don't really know what to say or like to give too much away too soon. But I've always wanted to get involved with everything you do with Scottish Wrestling Network. But podcast, I'm happy to be on. But the star for 10, it eluded me. Oh God, it was years ago.
I know, and I was messaging you, because to be honest, I would have probably had you really early on, but when I saw that, I was like, right, I'm going to kind of wait. I'm going to wait it out. And like you're saying, then we've got more stuff to speak about. If I contacted you around about the start of doing the podcast, we would have had nothing about ICW. Nothing. True, because it would have been in the future. But we've got plenty to cover in this next little bit, hopefully, while both of our technology survives at the moment. But fingers crossed and touch wood and all that kind of stuff. But the first question in our podcast is a very relaxed podcast. It's very, very similar to the vibes. We're just chill. We have a little bit of a chat about wrestling, and maybe we'll spin off and talk about stuff until you tell me something like so recent that you've started watching for the first time and I feel old. That's pretty much how this works at this point. But the first question is always the same. How did you get into pro wrestling? So what was the moment? What did you watch? What was the thing that got you hooked on this pro wrestling thing?
Well, it kind of like, the first like memory I've got of wrestling is really like, I can remember like in primary two, there was like, you know, they do like show and tell, people like, everybody in your class brings stuff in and all that. I remember a guy in my class brought in like a Shawn Michaels figure, and I just remember it just by his gear, you know, like just the white tights with the crosses up it, and just like, you know, everybody's like into toys or whatever, like any kind of toy, but it was just something about it. I was like, you know, you hear the WWE, but you don't really look into it or whatever. And then I can remember, like, you know, on Sky Sports, they used to do, like, well, obviously, it's through the day, it would be, like, This Week in WWE or Velocity or whatever, these recap shows.
Yeah.
And it was Shawn Michaels super kicking as a chef, you know, the segments they done when Triple H was trying to get him back and he was working as a chef and kicked the wee girl and then he quit and then the thing went on fire. And it was just, I think it was just, like, nothing to do with wrestling actually got me into wrestling. And then that Christmas, for Christmas, I got WrestleMania 25, and then it was Shawn Michaels again versus The Undertaker, which is still my favourite match ever. But I've watched that match on repeat, and I think it's the match I've watched the most. But yeah, it was just that, those instances, and then from about late 2009 to present day, I've just been wrestling daft, I suppose.
So 2009 then, that's pretty good year, like, because you said you had the Shawn Michaels stuff, and it's very weird as someone who started watching when it was original DX, and hear someone brought into it due to the, like, I think that was their last like reunion tour.
Yeah, they had the VA, and then that was the final act or whatever. Well, the kind of four, but we'll not. I don't know what we think about the fourth one, but you know, like you say, a lot of people obviously think, compared to like the 2006 run and the 2009 run, that's kind of watered down from the original stuff. But it's like, I was so young, but I was like 7 or 8, and like that they were my favourites, DX, and obviously it's a completely different version to DX and like the Attitude Era, but still, it's crazy the effect it had like years later.
Well, like you're saying, I think it's one of those things where they grew with the core audience of the show, but old folks like myself were growing out of that. I mean, I still find the toilet humor hilarious because I'm still a child at heart anyway. But it was like they grew with the audience, but the audience that was like, oh, I remember the Attitude Era, they just, that it wasn't them that were the target audience at that time. So DX, what a time. So was that when it was Hornswoggle throwing it around about then as well? Or that was then, wasn't it? Little People's Court.
Yeah, like if he was the mascot or something, I can remember.
That was it.
Yeah. Oh, but then it's funny because my mom actually got like tickets through her work to obviously staying in Scotland, but obviously she managed to get tickets for a Newcastle show. It was like DX's last stand. Mm. And I thought like, oh, it was amazing to see Shawn Michaels live, because in the main event it was Shawn Michaels and Triple H versus Legacy. So yeah, it was I just loved that run.
So did you get to that show? Do you say that was you
got? Yeah, I got into it. I was raging though, because like before it just went with my dad, but I wanted the glow sticks, you know, because that was a big thing at the time, and we're like, yeah. Oh, we'll get them at the interval, but they sold out, so I'll never let them forget that. But never got my glow sticks.
That was an amazing money spinner, because I think they were like £10 for two.
Yeah,
and that was it. And I think I remember reading a story. I think it was Chris Jericho who got so much heat that he got thrown at him, and he kept challenging people to throw them at him. And people were raging at him afterwards. I was like, why? People are going to throw them all at me, and then they're going to go back to the merch stand to pay another £10 and get another lot. So there you go. That's your money. So first favourites then, Shawn Michaels. You mentioned that. That's pretty much a firm favourite there. Triple H is in there as well because of the whole DX thing. Was there anyone else that kind of drew your eye that you were like, oh, this guy is, this girl, this guy, this, they're the best?
I think, like, again, I think Shawn Michaels is maybe the initial one that caught my eye. He probably is, like, my favourite ever. But, like, around that time, so, like, late Ruthless Aggression, remember my first, like, kind of, like everybody, it was probably Jeff Hardy and then Edge as well, like, during that time. I just think they, those, like, the, like that late kind of era, Jeff, Edge, Shawn Michaels, about CM Punk in there as well. Yeah, just that era.
Not a bad lot to be a fan of. So when you got into that time, 2009, were you aware of just how much history was behind that? Were you able to grab DVDs, videos, those things that you rewind backwards? Did you get a chance to watch any of that, kind of get a bit of backstory in these things?
I think, like, you know, when yourself, like, when you're, like, you love wrestling so much and love all things WWE, you, like, you're on the internet all the time and you're looking up. You know, I remember I used to always watch like pay-per-view highlights like of years gone past, and just, you know, it'd be like a 7-minute video obviously over music, and it would just be like working out where everything was at. And yeah, but I can remember as well, like you say, like DVDs and stuff of previous matches, you know, and you kind of like fill in the pieces of like how long people have been wrestling, and you know, when they got to WWE, did they have a career before WWE and stuff like that. So yeah, all things. But then again, probably that goes back to, you know, like maybe the mid-80s with WWE. Like before that, there's a certain bit of wrestling history, even like now, I'm still probably not that familiar with and don't really, you know, pay that much attention to like wrestling history before the 1980s, because, do you know what I mean? Like, you don't go that far back as well, because again, like some people think it's great, a lot of that stuff, but it's not really my thing.
So sometimes, I mean, The modern day kind of pick and choose bits from 70s, 80s to bring forward, and then that's the bit that's kind of you take from there. I realized when I said that I'd go back and watch your VHS, you're of an age where YouTube was really kind of the thing. So that would have been your kind of binge watching of anything, because there's always those cheeky people that upload full shows and when they shouldn't. And it's the modern day tape trading. I'm not saying that you did torrents or LimeWire to find these wrestling shows, but there's always one person that uploads the whole thing. And you're like, great, that's excellent.
Yeah,
it's the only time I've watched a whole AEW show, because someone uploaded it the next day, and I was like, YouTube, thank you.
Oh, thanks for that.
So again, to this nine, then, were you aware of anything of a UK scene at that point? Because I mean, were you aware of any shows around about where you lived?
To be honest, like, no, like, I mean, I can try and think back to think, like, maybe I've seen a poster of a wrestling thing, but never took it in. Just kind of thought, that's like WWE. It's the, kind of the same thing, but never really picked up on any companies or who was running them. It wasn't a thing I was probably aware of until the Insane Fight Club documentaries. I think that's like most people, which is obviously like a certain type of wrestling. Obviously it's like a over 18s product, so it's very like very grungy, very like ECW like. I can remember that's obviously how it was presented, as if this like crazy edgy product in Scotland. But again, that was it wasn't really something I like looked into a lot. And like, you know, there's wrestling outside of WWE, but you don't really, obviously it's harder to access, as like you said, it's like harder to find. But I wasn't really aware till to probably about I started training. It was probably about when I started to, you know, work out the Scottish wrestling scene and you know, how many companies are in different areas and stuff, until like I actually got involved. I probably was the first time I've been aware of it.
I was saying before my internet rudely interrupted us there, that it seemed to be my people my age was like Channel 4. It was that brought us in 2000 when they brought all the pay-per-views in, they had Heat. But it seems to be the younger generation, like yourself, that ICW Fight Club documentary was just the biggest thing to bring them into wrestling. Because everyone I've spoke to that's maybe come into wrestling the last 10 years or so, they always cite that 2014 documentary. Because, what, 10 o'clock on BBC One? And everyone saw it. You saw Grado, you saw Jester, you saw the madness of wrestling. And even folk that weren't that interested were like, this looks amazing. I'm going to try and check it out. And that was how many people's journey began, like yourself. So was that the reason you went, right, I need to find a school. I need to go and do some wrestling. Or was there anything else that brought you to actually start training?
I think, like, again, I don't know if it was specifically like inspired by that documentary, because I think it would have been like 10 or 11 at the time it came out. But I think it was just one of those things. I was really like, I'd started high school and I was really just like, I wanted to do something. I don't know what, like, but WWE's always been my like obsession or passion or whatever you want to put it. And I've never, like, it never, you know, it doesn't dawn on you like it's something you can do. Like, I don't know why, it just never clicked with me that is actually like people do this. Because you always think when you see on TV and you see like, you think they're not real people. Like, I don't know, how would you even get involved in something like that? But it was just, I think it was like looking online at clubs and different things going on in the area and stuff, and like wrestling was there. And then like, I think it's when, you know, I went to my first couple of sessions, it kind of like clicked very quickly. I was like, oh, like, I don't know why this is my thing. I don't know why I didn't pursue this. But I think I was so young. It wasn't something I thought like you can do young. But obviously a lot of people in Scottish wrestling all like around the world, like, they do start young. So it's just kind of happened. It was weird. It was never my I'm definitely going to do that the first time I get the chance, but it happened. It was strange.
So so you said you're younger and you're all consumed by wrestling. Were you a bit of a yarder? Did you have a trampoline? Did you know a guy that had a trampoline?
I've had friends, like, and my cousins as well, that we did like wrestle on the trampoline and that, but you just like everybody done it. Like, it was just kind of a thing you done. Do you know what I mean? It wasn't like, we never had like any like sort of backyard wrestling federations or anything like that. But
you did have a storyline. You didn't have a ring name. You had nothing. No. It was just a bit of wrestling in the back garden. That's fine. I mean, like, for me growing up, it was always, I was always Jeff Hardy, which is ridiculous now when you look at just how my body is made up. But I was always Jeff Hardy because I was the only one willing to jump off stuff. That was pretty much the reason why I got to be Jeff. So you started training, and you said you're quite happy to speak about it, so we will, but you know, not all of it's going to be in a positive light probably. But you started with SSW. So Scottish School of Wrestling, you know, sounds like it was going to be a pretty good one because it says Scottish wrestling and it's a school.
Yeah.
You know, that ticks all the boxes.
That's all you need. I get it, like, you know, SSW, but like, you know, it was a local school in like West Lothian, staying in West Lothian. So it was one of those things that, you know, when I was 13 when I started, it was like, you know what I mean, there was no really, when you're that young, and there's not really many options that train, like, they actually do like kids' classes. So, yeah.
I think that point as well, they were the only place there, because I think Reckless started 2013, something like that ish.
Something, yeah.
But then, so, yeah, if you want to do some wrestling, and not everyone's got the luxury of being able to go to Glasgow or ever to do this training. So you just got to make do with what you can. First session ends. I don't know, was like mats? Did you see the ring the first time? What was your kind of experience from the first couple sessions?
I can just remember when I went the first time, I'd like seen the unit before my first day of training. It was kind of like anybody that had ever been there. It was like, you would think the place was haunted, right? It's this horrible old building, and like it had like a first floor on it that was like a matted area. I think it was like used for like some sort of MMA or judo thing as well. It was like a a venue that was used for like different things. And then on the downstairs, there was a made up ring, but like it was kind of the training was split between, sometimes it was upstairs, sometimes it was downstairs. So yeah, it was mainly on like mats for, I want to say like a couple months before then, like it was more like in-ring stuff. But yeah, the first few sessions were just like a shock. Cause again, like even though it was SSW, of course, it was still like wrestling, obviously, like across the board is like, it's fundamentally the same thing, but there's obviously like different degrees and levels to it. But yeah, like still like a lot of the stuff there was still just like, you know, wrestling training with roles and stuff like that. And it was a shock to the system, like quickly, because it's conditioning that's it's unlike anything.
So as someone quite young, were you outside of that, did you do anything sporty wise, was it a bit of football or what was your kind of background?
Not really, no. I've never really been like into like not that sporty, never been in any clubs or that or anything like that. I'm not like, I wouldn't say I was unathletic, but I wouldn't say I was particularly like great at any one sport or whatever, but not unathletic either, you get what I mean? I'm kind of somewhere in the middle.
I remember those days when that was the case. My only cardio, I think, when I was younger, was running from school to the chippy, and that was it. And then I stopped running. I know, pay for it now. Every time I stand up, my knees go, no, you shouldn't have had that. So that must mean you made your debut quite quickly then, because I've got your debut down as 2016.
2016, yeah. So I like started in February 2015. So 14 months, and I debuted when I was 14. So yeah, which I mean, like 14 months is like it's a long, it's kind of a long period of time, but it's also like, you know, it's one of those weird things you think, was it long enough before debuting? But it's like, you know, when are you ever going to be ready? But I wasn't thrown in after like 2 months of that, so I still had a bit of training before being in front of a crowd.
So how did you find that training then? So we talked about it, like where you started off though. Was there anything that you particularly, I don't know, struggled with, or was there anything that you excelled at that you loved doing, whether it was a bit technical, a bit high flying? What was your genre? What was your preferred method of doing the wrestling?
I really liked, just as what you see on like TV and stuff, I really liked when first, you know, learning how to do chaining and stuff and just feeling that. I do quite like chaining. I wouldn't particularly say, I don't know who would say they liked bumping. I think I struggled with that initially. Like I can remember, like I couldn't get my feet off the ground. You know, everybody has that, they're natural. You naturally just, you don't want to do it. And you're like, no, I want to do it. But your body's like, what are you doing? And you're trying to like fight that urge all the time. So you just like, I think it took me a while to like, properly get my feet off the ground. Mm-hmm. But yeah, hitting the ropes was a nightmare. I know that's probably, you know, a common thing that wrestlers say, but you know, yeah, I think you get used to that in different rings as well. But yeah, the pain of that, you know, that looks like the funnest time, and it's just agony.
And I've heard stories about particularly the SSW ring wasn't the most forgiving when it came to doing anything in it. I think it was like you're saying, they did boxing MMA. I think it was an old boxing ring that they had for a good while.
I don't know what it was made out of. I swear it was made, like I'm leaving kind of, I think it was made out of tires. Like it was a kind of like a makeshift. I don't even know what it was made of, but like I can like hear the thud it makes. Like there was no giving it. But yeah, I don't know. I don't know what it was made of. I don't even know what I know.
So according to Cage Match, which is not a really reliable source for this particular company, your debut is in April 2016, and it was a triple threat. Yeah. It was yourself, Lucha DS, and the then Brandon Adams, now known as Alistair Caron. When you look at the trajectory of the three years, that's not a bad first match, because where you've gone from there. What was your memories of that first match then? Were you nervous going in? What was your kind of vibe for it?
I think going into it, I think I was told they were running the Blackburn Community Centre, because obviously SSW ran monthly New Eagle, and then the Blackburn Community Centre was this new thing. I think they called it, like, it was Evo or something it was called, but it was like a family kind of, you know, like, what would you say? I hate the word trainee, but like, you know, like beginners, whatever, you know.
It was like NXT, for lack of a better term.
Yeah. I don't think SSW needed an NXT.
No. You know?
But they had it anyway. We got told about that like 8 weeks before the show happened. And me and another guy, Lewis, were debuting on that show. And I got told 8 weeks before that I was against Brandon. and that was cool to be working with him. And it was going on last as well, which, you know, whatever that means. But yeah, and then I think like 2 weeks before Lucha got added, and it was a triple threat, which again I was like obviously really excited for, because like some people don't, but I love the idea of, like, triple threats, fatal four, which is anything multi-man. I just think like if you're watching it, it's just more exciting. I think they're harder to do, definitely, because we've got more parts to think about and where's everybody at, you know. But it's just, it's more exciting because there's obviously there's more bodies. But yeah, just like the day of that like show, like I think I've obviously always get nervous before I go out, and like there's obviously a pre-show anxiety before you step out. But like I've never felt like that day, and I can like I'm not to that degree of like nerves. I think anybody with any like wrestler would attest it, or perform or whatever, like you can train as much as you want for it, but then as soon as you're in the ring and there's a crowd, it's just like a totally different thing. I think I was like going at 100 miles an hour during that match and just like went so quick. But yeah, it's the most like apprehensive, nervous excitement I've ever felt. And yeah, it's a strange feeling to look back, because I don't think I've ever had anything since then. Obviously done a few things that have been bigger or whatever, but never as nervous as I was for my first match.
So you weren't Luke Kyro at that point, though. You were Benedict Thatcher. And yeah. when I was doing my research, I forgot about this name until I went through the research. And I was going, I remember that name, and I can't remember where. And then I had to double check. I literally had to go. Sometimes cage match can be a bit weird with who they lump names with. I think for example, like Blue Thunder up in WrestleZone, he's the Bulgarian Baker. He's never been the Bulgarian Baker, but suddenly on cage match he is. So I thought, right, a little Google, because SSW, of course, their Facebook's gone, their website's gone. So I really had to rely on just a hope and a prayer. And I found the picture with you, the SPWO UK Championship. And I was like, oh my God, that's Luke Kyro.
I know. It was me all along.
Benedict Thatcher, though. How did you get it lumped with that name?
Oh, really? I still wonder that. I think it was like, obviously it's a Tory way of heat, which again, I was 14 and I don't think I look particularly like to fit that, you know. Obviously some people have adopted that and it maybe works a bit better for them, but I think Benedict Thatcher, I don't think it's a great name at all, but the initial name was Lucien Thatcher the Third, right, which I think is worse. Yeah,
it is.
Yeah, it's really bad, right? But I think it was because EC3 was popular at the time, so I think it was coming for the three thing. I was just like, it's one of those things, like you're just kind of like, I think you downplay its importance, like, oh, what does a name matter? Obviously it does matter, but yeah, it's not the greatest name. Kind of as soon as I got the chance to, I was like, yeah, I'm being more me on the other side of this.
That's the weird thing. Imagine putting a 14-year-old who, I mean, not, let's be honest, you don't look like a Tory. They have a look.
Yeah.
and trying to put that on it. I couldn't remember. I think I was mixing up with Tex Benedict. I thought you had an American gimmick or something like that. Oh, that's awful. I mean, you see guys like Thatcher Wright being a perfect example. He's got a face that just goes, I mean, I don't think he is in real life. I don't know. The only time I interviewed him, he stayed as Thatcher Wright.
Yeah.
And it both impressed me and fucking annoyed me at the same time, because I was watching it going, you're very good at this. I hate you.
I mean, fine line, but yeah, no, totally. I was told when I was obviously later on at GPWA, like, oh, you know, like we've already got that name, so like we can't really use it. I'm like, don't worry. I was never planning on it, but yeah, fits some people better than others.
I mean, you're teaming with obviously Lucien Maynard Smith, so who's now Luke Aldridge as well. Yeah. So that could have been a bit weird if you're both Lucien.
Two Lucians, aye. God.
What a time. So of course you did. You won your SPW, whoever it is, SPW UK Championship. How was that then? Because I don't know if you're how much of a belt guy you are. I know myself as a big nerd, as you can see behind me, I do have replica belts.
Oh, European, yeah, it's nice.
I don't take them to shows anymore, but because apparently the new rule is if you take a replica belt to a show, you have to defend it. And I'm happy with just not taking the belts to shows now.
Yeah.
What was it like being trusted in winning a title for the first time so early on in your career?
I mean, yeah, like totally. Like again, it's something like again, like I'm still proud of that. Like because I debuted, and so we had, you know, these other shows. So I debuted in the Regal in the August, and it was this, it's this 10-man match, whatever it was. It was called TMT, and I was number one in it. And then I won in the January. It was called King of the Bang, which again, the Bathgate's built on bangs, so I get what they're going with, but it's a bit of a strange name. But yeah, so I won that. So it was kind of like the Money in the Bank concept. And then, you know, and for months I would kind of, obviously, but it was like a niche audience, and you would have your regulars and that kind of followed it. And you know, I kept seeing in promos, just whether anybody picked this up, it's only me that got it. I always said that I was 11 out of 10, and I always used to go with that. And then in the TM, the 10-man title match, I like cashed in as number 11. So it's kind of like, you know, it's like alluding to it. No one would have got it, and it was maybe only to my benefit. But yeah, it was cool because it was two people left the ring, the lights went out, lights came on, the music hit, and I genuinely feel like I'd love to share it at some point. Like it did get a genuinely quite a good reaction, you know. But cash-ins usually do, but yeah, like the SPW UK title. I wish I had SSW in the name. I think it was a partnership they had years ago, but it was viewed as their, like, you know, as their secondary men's title. So it was like the, you know, the Intercontinental. So it was like the workhorse thing of SSW. So the Intercontinental champion of Bathgate. I don't know how much weight that carries, but you know, but it's a belt that like BT Gunn and Andy Wilde, and you know, there's a few like decent names have held it. And I had the belt for 6 months, but you know, it's something I'm proud of, and I wouldn't, like, I don't regret it at all, as if to go, you know, oh, I wish it had been different or whatever. Because at 15, to be like in that position on a show is still something, like, even not to whatever level. But yeah, I'm still proud of it. And obviously, like you say, I do like belts, like like the idea of being a champion, because being a champion is a different spot on the show, and it's to try and make that entertaining and, you know, build up challengers. But, you know, to the opportunity that would have had in SSW was probably limited. But yeah.
I like that you, in your own head, that you were making a story for yourself and adding subtleties using the 11 out of 10 thing, which as a 14, 15-year-old, is probably not something that would come to mind to a lot of people. But I suppose if you're so ingrained in the WWE style of things, they always, maybe not so much nowadays so much, but they always try to keep a through line through things. So you had that through line through every show, and like I say, nobody may have got it, but you did, and that was the most important thing because you believed it as you went through it. I was going through your opponents in SSW, and then we'll move on because we don't want to make this an SSW podcast. Especially because seeing the folk that you were in the ring with, I mean, especially where they're at now, the likes of Lucha DS, who we mentioned, Luke Aldridge as well, Paul Huntley, who we'll get into a bit more in depth later, because I was so surprised to find out where he is at now. We've got Jason Reed, we've got Mike Musso, and one name that came out of the blue that I was very intrigued to talk about was Johnny Storm.
Yeah, Johnny Storm.
Again, so what would you be at this point? Was 16, something like that, when you're 15, going in the ring?
Yeah, 15.
Still 15, Johnny. And you're in the ring with Johnny Storm, who is a legend. I mean, that point, still a legend. He still is now. But so what was it like getting in the ring with? I mean, I don't know, did you know much about Johnny Storm at this point, or just a reputation? You heard his name. What was it like going into that match?
Well, like, obviously I know, like, you know, the matches Johnny Storm and Jody Fleischer had in Japan, and, you know, you look, go 20 years back working with AJ Styles, and, you know, he's done so much, especially over British wrestling. But he used to come in and do seminars. Like, there was about, I think there was two seminars, or maybe one or two before I got the chance to work with him on the show. But yeah, just like his view on things and the way, like he obviously has been at this for a while and stuff. So it was, it was probably my first, like, biggest match, because it was an import, per se. Coming from England, not much of an import, but obviously, you know, a big name. But yeah, it was, I was really cool with that, like, to be, especially that young, to be working with Johnny and getting, like, you know, being so early on and him being so, like, experienced. It was a completely different mindset and approach to a match.
So after that, of course, you've 2018 arrived and you lost the SPWO UK Championship to the now Shame on A. And yeah. that was your SSW portion of your career. Did you make the decision to move to a different school? What was the decision for leaving SSW?
I think I always knew, right? And it was always like saying, and I think like, especially when I was 14, and I'd always felt like it anyway, and I'd like met Ravi Davey and some other people from the first time. I think I knew in my heart, like GPWA was where I always wanted to go. But obviously like you need to be 16 to be at GPWA. So it was like, if I can't do it now, like I'm not going to think about it. I'm just going to do my thing now. And you know, you take everything as it comes. Mm-hmm. I think just certain things like the Regal, I don't know the intricacies of it. We weren't able to use the Regal anymore for whatever reason. And then we went to the Scout Hall and then it went to the Bathgate Legion. Kind of just the energy had been like, we went from a Saturday night to a Sunday afternoon. And it was just kind of, things were kind of falling apart. People were leaving, people were going. The timing just felt right. Just stuff was up. There was a GPW intake in the March. And it was kind of like, you know, logistically, how am I going to get to Glasgow every week and however many sessions I do? And it was kind of that concern. But I think I just like, it was just a weird feeling. Like I was like, it's now. And I feel like it's now. And obviously, like I still admire and like think fondly back on my time at SSW, because you know, for all like its opinion SSW garnered or has amongst wrestling, you know, I think in you know the past few years especially, like we noticed a lot of these issues were like, you know, industry wide, so you know it was across the board, and there was some good guys there, so I don't look back on it bad at all. And I was always treated well, like you say, like, you know, from the matches I've had. I think I had a good run there because I was only on shows for a year and a half, especially being that young. But you know, I always wanted to be at GPWA, so obviously they ended like quite soon after that. It was a couple months after, but yeah, lost the title to Shane Monet, and that was me away, and he doesn't let me forget either. But
so that's the thing, I suppose at 15 you would be naive to this stuff that came out in 2020, so it's not something that thankfully, you're not like dwelling on it, going, "Oh, wish I saw when." But
yeah.
At 15, you would be none the wiser. You were just going to do a bit of wrestling. That's pretty much all you were going for. Right. So that's SSW ticked off. Let's move on from that. So 2018, I've got your next match after that was PWE, which is quite a step up. So we'll kind of scale back to GPWA. When you had that first intake there, did you think it was a whole new ball game? What was the kind of reaction? Did you go in with any confidence going, "Oh, I've wrestled for the last couple of years. This will be quite straightforward," or how was that?
I think I kind of approached it like, again, like it's good going in with experience, obviously, in the intake, but it stripped me right back. Like from the first session I was in, and you've got Jack Jester, Lionheart, Riddle, BT Gunn, Stevie Boy, and Kaylee, like all sitting on the apron. And you know, I remember like the first intake and the first session we had of like block one or whatever, because the models kind of changed a bit in the training program, but at the time it was like 8 weeks, and I don't know that, like, you know, the beginners now, because there's different things with iron girders and stuff, but yeah, just the basics and the way they do things, and you have your assessment, and it was like it's a totally different, it's like a well-oiled machine, and you very much felt like that, you know, like just when you walk into the asylum and just the, it's huge, like there's two rings, and you know what I mean, it's just this, it's a completely different world almost, and you know how you get in everybody's different perspectives every week, and how everything was taught differently, and you kind of, you know, like it's fine tuning and ironing out like issues that, you know, like I wasn't like thinking, "Oh, I'm confident I can wrestle." It was obviously going in like with open ears to like, obviously I want to get better, so I'm here to do that, and starting from the ground up again, I think was like so beneficial.
Because it was like 10 months between you finishing up in Bathgate to making that debut again at PWE. I would love to speak about your opponents, but one of them I can't. You linked up with Paul Huntley, who is now wrestling, seems to be all over the world as Paul Hubris, which I can't remember who I was speaking to when I found that out. I might have been probably one of the Casino Brutal guys. Probably.
Rob and Mikey, yeah.
Yeah, one of them probably. It was one of them that maybe revealed it to me that was the case. But So you and Paul, of course, he would have been someone you would have been interacting with, wrestled with as well at Bathgate. Yeah. So was that just an instant connection going, right, we've seen that, and now we're in GPWA together. I was just an instant gravitation for the two of you.
Yeah. No, I think so. I think, like, I remember, like, because obviously we had, Paul had left, like, SSW a couple of weeks before me, or whatever. I don't know what date he actually left, but we started at the same time and we're part of the same intake and stuff. So I think it was cool because we kind of, like, we'd been through that together. Like you say, we were friends in SSW, and then to go into GPWA, it was great for, like, travel and going through that together, because it can be tough at times. Like you say, like, it's a 10-month period, which isn't long, but, you know, you've got to keep your motivation up and to try, like, what we're working towards to be better and to do a show. So started in GPW in the March, and then we were in, like, the main class by, like, the July. And I think, like, our second session, we worked a tag team match with Danny Cantrell and Ryan King. And, yeah, I think, like, it was a really good training match. And, again, I think it was, like, that moment, and we just kind of started working together and training more, and it was just coming up with, like, I think we kind of felt that we were going to be a tag team on the show, and it moved towards that. And then, obviously, I think it was just one Sunday we're in training, and Adrian dropped the message, messenger, just, you know, casually going, are you free this date? And then, yeah, that was the kind of the first, like, well, it was the first, you know, moment being back on a totally new run. But, yeah. Back, it's a weird thing looking back, because obviously, you know, it was in the match, and it was quite a short match, and but I can remember when we came back, I remember saying to Adrian, you know, like thanks a lot, like, really, like, thanks a lot, because I don't think Adrian realised, like I said, it was great being in GPWA and being on such a bigger show, but you have those moments of self-doubt, because there's a lot of people in GPWA, and you feel like, you know, am I going to break through, are we good enough, and when you get that, and, you know, I just said to Adrian, you know, thanks a lot for that, and he kind of went off, like, you know, in his way, just shrugged it off as if it was nothing, but yeah, it was. It's a bit surreal now looking back at how it all played out.
I love hearing Lionheart stories and Adrian stories, yeah. Just because he seems like the coolest motherfucker in existence. Yeah. He just, every time I hear a story, just, it's always casual. It's always like, well, yeah, we'll do this. Okay, cool. And then you go, thank you. And he goes, oh, what for? Kind of just moves on with his life. It was just
nothing, eh? Yeah.
Nothing fills me with regret more than he wrestled up in Aberdeen in 2019, right at the start of the year, and he just had such cool aura about him, and I was just too nervous to speak to him, and nothing fills me with regret more that I didn't just at least go hi to him.
Yeah,
it was just just coolest guy on the planet.
Not at all.
Every story kind of every wrestler seems to confirm that. There was always two ways about it. He was a bit of a dick, but once he knew him, he was just the coolest guy on the planet, and that showed. The name. So Bendik Thatcher, you couldn't use that, unfortunately. You were gutted at the thought, of course. How did Luke Kyro come about then?
I think, like, I think because I didn't like my name so much, and I wanted to be more myself, and obviously I'd worked as a bad guy before, so it was being first time, that was another thing, it was a shock. I'd never worked as a good guy, like, properly, and I was kind of just a bit, that was a new thing as well, and obviously Bendik Thatcher just isn't going to cut it. I didn't want any adaptation of that name, I just wanted a completely fresh start. Looking back, I don't know if I should have made that decision, but I just, because I hated that name so much, I just wanted to be, like, my real name, I just wanted to be Luke, but I just, you know, I wanted something to sound cool. I just wanted, like, a name that was just something, and a name that I, like, had figured out. I'm not a huge Star Wars fan or anything, but the name Kylo Ren, I just really like the name Kylo, and, you know, you get a lot of, you know, Gargano, Jericho, and, like, how these names just, they, I think they sound good when the announcer's pronouncing them, I'm thinking about it like that, but if you, like, search Luke Kylo on Google, it's, like, Luke Skywalker versus Kylo Ren, and I'm kind of like, I don't want to set myself up for that. So I put it as Kyro, because then it's like when you look up, it's just me that comes up. So it's kind of, it's a weird story, you know, but it was all about how it sounded. There's no really much more to it.
See, again, though, we went back to you thinking things more logically that just makes sense. You've kind of, again, 16, 17, no way that you would think of branding yourself at that point, going, well, I can't be this name because this will pop up if I Google it. And that's, did you have any, I don't know, any aspirations of like the marketing side of wrestling at all, or marketing in general, or because it just sounds like you've very much thought it through. Like, yeah, you're not just going, right, I thought this name, I like, I'll use my own name. I know Kyro, Kylo. Yeah. No, I need to Google it to make sure that that people can find me. Oh, I've done that now. I don't know. It's just the young people do this now. Is this just the...
I don't know. It's been my just strange way of thinking. But it's funny you say that, like, in my shoot job in other areas of life, like, people have said, like, you should go to marketing. But I think that's just the way I view things. I don't know. Like, maybe the why and how it looks and how it sounds. So, yeah, and I always like colour and design and all that sort of thing. And that aspect of wrestling, you know, like, just, like silly things, like how everything looks and, and, you know, just the presentation of it all, and I think so. That's one of my favorite aspects of it. Yeah,
I think it goes back to like you're saying, you're just mad into WWE, and it was all about the brand. It was all about the catchphrases and the people being able to say these names, search them, shout them, and ring announcers being able to say it in a cool way. And you may not have realized it, but you seem to have put. You seem to have a really good brain for this sort of thing. That it clearly has worked. That you've been able to put this together. So you did that. You're back in your GPWA now, doing PWE and all that kind of stuff. Teaming with Paul Huntley for a bit, and I think he disappeared around about, what was it, 2019-ish?
Kind of. 2019, yeah.
Came Paul Hubris elsewhere. I'll keep seeing Paul. I have contacted him. I thought I'll see if I can try and get him onto the podcast, but. It has not happened as yet. But you had a lot of like big matches when we look at the experience of the guys now, like The Purge, of course, you're in there with. You wrestled Leighton Buzzard in a singles match.
Yeah.
One that kind of popped up on this portion, your 2019 area of your career, was Stevie Boy.
Yeah. So
at this point, you would have been training for about, what is it, just over a year now, a year and a half at GPWA. And you're in the ring with Stevie Boy in Bathgate, of all places.
Yeah, I know.
So what was it like going in the ring with one of your trainers in the place where you started your whole wrestling career?
Not at all. It's surreal. Like, it's, again, I love the Regal, right? And I've always loved it. It's just such a, it's like built for wrestling. Like, it's just a cool venue. It's got a cool vibe about it. Oh, pardon the pun, but like Stevie Boy had just came back at Chuck's house party, and obviously, like, I think Stevie Boy in 2019, like, was, you know, he come back in July and he was like the wrestler of the year, and he's only been active for like 5 months, and the reaction he got, and just how Stevie Boy as a wrestler, like, Stevie Boy is genuinely like one of my like favorite wrestlers in Scotland, just by the way he moves, his matches, Stevie Boy's cool, and I think he always has been. And I remember, you know, getting the message to say it's you versus Stevie Boy and the Regal. Like, the Regal especially is just like, yeah, it's crazy how it comes full circle in the same venue. But I can remember, like, Stevie Boy, we were in the opener, and, you know, Stevie Boy got to the crowd, and I can't remember what the first thing we done was, but, like, I felt we were chaining, and I can't remember at what point, but something, like, we were in whatever hold, and then I suddenly had him in another hold, and I was just like, he's wrestling himself here. Like, he's not even, like, he's that good. It's almost like I don't even need to be here. And how he riled the crowd up, and just how, like, just sheerly on based on how good Stevie Boy is. It's one of my favorite matches I've had, especially because he was just coming off and just coming back, and it was one of his first few matches back, and it was in the Regal. You know, it's got a lot of sentimental value.
I just imagine. So in this scenario, you're the broomstick, the fabled broomstick. Yeah. Stevie just went right. Stay still. I'll do everything for you. Got it.
Fire away.
So after that, of course, then you made your ICW debut. So that was just pre shutdown and pandemic and what have you. You were in the ring with Craig Anthony for ICW Gonzo. So ICW. So 2014, you would have seen this documentary. I'd say Fight Club. You've seen Grado, Jack Jester, what have you. Now it's 2020. Was it 6 years later ish? You've trained with Jack Jester. No doubt you've probably seen a show with Grado on, and now you're wrestling for ICW. So when you were told, or who did you tell? Was it just everyone needed to know? What was your kind of reaction to being booked for ICW?
I think it was like, again, obviously when it was officially like announced on social media or whatever, I think it was like my most liked tweet or whatever, obviously, because it's like a big moment for any wrestler. But Yes, it's always like it's. I think it's sometimes it's weird because like you train so hard and you do the GPWA shows, which are obviously great and have such a high quality and standard. Obviously, like you know you're working towards ICW, but you don't know when that moment comes. But like I think it's just trying to like at the time I was trying to like you say like you're trying to appreciate like you only get your first match one time like in a company you only get your debut once. So I was trying to live in the moment of that. And Gonzo was a new show, obviously in the asylum and that. And yeah, Craig's obviously immensely talented. And to have like that kind of match with him in my first match for how I viewed ICW was like, yeah, it was just what I wanted. Because again, you always like, you know, when you're training, you're working, you're trying to imagine what will it be like, when will it be, who will it be against. But yeah, it was that was cool. It was the night before the Square Go as well, so there was a good buzz about the place. And yeah.
I know it's a rowdy crowd because I mean,
it's different.
if you're going to the asylum for a Gonzo show, it's the hardcore that go. It's the ones that are just ICW in their veins, yeah. For better or for worse. So mm-hmm. Yeah, when you're going in there, you've been wrestling family shows for years, mm-hmm. where you have to kind of mind your P's and Q's. You kind of if they shout yeah. swearing at you, they're not really supposed to. Whereas you're now in ICW and. They tell you what they think. If you fuck up,
they'll let you know.
They'll tell you straight away. So oh, yeah. was that very conscious? You said you're nervous because it's debut anyway, but you're very yeah. conscious of that new audience environment that you're going into.
I think like again, it's a weird one because like you say, I've only ever done family shows, and everybody knows what ICW is like, or like the crowd is like, but you don't really know what to like expect. You don't know how they'll react to you, how they'll treat you. But I think it's just going in with that. Mentality of like if they don't like me I'll be okay, like if you know what I mean, like I need to just do my thing the best I can. I can't control, I'm not going to try and make people like me, I'm just going to do my thing and see how it goes. There's a level of intimidation, but like because the company's big, you know, it's obviously to the streaming platform I originally went to, but obviously it's still a big audience and it's a big company in worldwide independent wrestling, so you're like, you know, you can think about it too differently, but you know, too difficultly, sorry. And then when you get in the ring, you go, right, it's a wrestling match. Same as I've always done. You need to treat it like that. Because I think if you get too consumed with the, like, you wouldn't do anything if you actually realize what it was.
That, yeah, absolutely. That sounds fair. So you had that match. You lost to Craig Anthony, so you couldn't go into the Square Go. Square Go happened. Yeah. And, you know, then the world ended.
Yep.
How did you kind of occupy yourself during that pandemic time?
Yeah, it's like it's strange because again, you love through that, eh? Like, well, everybody doing the same, and you think like, oh, it'll be funny looking back on this in years to come. But yeah, just the world shut down, and then you're just like, you kind of thought because again, like all of us were like, will it be a couple months or will it be a couple weeks? And obviously, like, better part of 2 years. But how to occupy myself? I had that. Obviously, I was working in the background, which was luckily. But I was fortunate at the time because the job I was in wasn't working from home. So I was still managing to get out like in a closed environment and still managing to like see a small social group. So that kept me going and really fortunate for that. Now looking back that I didn't, you know, go insane, stuck inside all the time. But it was about from the March to when we started, you know, when it restarted was about 6 months before like I had like something to live for again. Well, not something to live for, I mean like something to look forward to and stuff happening again, but you know, just biding time.
So that kind of outdoorsness, you're able to kind of keep yourself active and like you say mentally stimulated. Like us hermits who end up working from home and I've not returned to work. I've worked from home since March 2020. I have not gone back. So it's the reason why I have a podcast, because everyone went through the same three things. They made bread, they did Twitch, and they did a podcast. And you find one, and that's what you stay with. And most people went with Twitch. I stuck with a podcast, and here we are 2 years later. So, yeah, the closed doors tapings then. That's kind of how we're up to then.
Yeah.
When were you kind of informed that this was something that they were going to try and do?
I think the dates are right. I think it was the October it started. I might be wrong, but I think it was a couple of weeks before, just checking availability. And obviously, like, you know, God, if you don't know what to expect with the ICW audience, you really don't know what to expect with no audience. Like, it's just, it was this, what does it look like? What does it feel like? Because I think everybody that was getting the wrestling fix our entertainment, whatever, over the 6 months, you know, was WWE and AEW. So I think at the time I was, I'd love to wrestle in front of like nobody. Well, I've wrestled in front of crowds that were like next to nobody, but like,
I was going to say, I didn't want to say it, but I was like, you must have done some of those evil shows in front of single people.
You know, I don't know, like, I think one time there was like under 10, like, and I can just, it's tough. But yeah, at least this one, you're not working for a reaction. But yeah, didn't know what to expect. It's a couple of weeks before, and then just, you know, the apprehension going into it, as if, what does it look like? Because again, it's, you know, simple things of, I don't even know what the asylum will be like with nobody in it and how they're going to present it. But yeah.
Were you aware at that point that it was going to be on the WWE Network, or are you just kind of told, right, we're going to tape some shows and then see what happens?
I think, no, like, I know, I think in the August, it was like WWE had announced that independent wrestling was coming, you know, to the WWE Network, and it was ICW and stuff. And obviously they were uploading like shows from years ago. So like, when you find out you're going to work tapings for ICW, you're like, well, like, it could end up on the WWE Network, but you're kind of like, you know, like, content in real time being on the WWE Network, like, surely not. But because again, I thought it would be on maybe like a 2 year delay, or maybe it would come out in intervals, or maybe it would be match compilations because there's a lot of them. But yeah, it didn't, like, you kind of had the hope, like, how cool would this be if it was weekly on the network? But, you know, until actually, because I think we started in the October. And then, you know, until it started airing in the December, the end of November time, I think. And then, you know, the first time, it's just still a bit crazy. That's where you can watch it.
How many people did you try to send a link to once you found out, screenshot, that you're able to be searched on the WWE Network next to other Luke's? Luke Harper's the one that came to my head straight away. But
Luke Gallows. Luke Harper, Luke Gallows, Luke Kyro. I'm like,
It's a bit of an odd company, but still pretty cool nonetheless. I like that you actually know who you're between.
I know. I've not looked up that much.
But that's like, I mean, I know it's put in front of nobody, and that's a very tough experience. And like you say, but we all joke that you have wrestled in front of like 10 people before, so it's not really that bad. But even then, those 10 people still react. You hope. But this time you're now wrestling in front of just a camera. That's pretty much your only reaction now. And you've got to kind of rely on then the internet, I suppose, Twitter, to get your reactions and to what's happening. So did you find yourself... Again, someone's young anyway, you probably are all about the Twitter and Facebook and all that jazz. But were you very conscious of marketing yourself a bit more online to try and get that all connected, being on the WWE Network and try and get a bit of a fan following and at least try and get it all interworked?
Yeah, totally. Like, I think obviously, like, you know, when you've got the live crowds, you don't really need to like promote the show per se, because they're there, you know, they're experiencing it. But obviously when no one's ever seen it and it's new content, you know, I think everybody on the roster has that challenge to try and how do you engage people and like promote it as new content, and especially because it was a lot of new names, a lot of new like faces to the ICW at the time. And you know, you're trying to get so much promoted. But I think you just try to take that initiative the best you can to make sure that people were aware. But it's obviously helpful with being on the WWE Network.
That's not so bad. So I'm going through again your opponents here, and there's a lot of familiar faces through your time in other promotions, the likes of Craig Anthony, who you wrestled already, Jason Reed. You end up wrestling Jason Reed again. What was it like going back from wrestling him back in, what was it, 2016, 2017, to then wrestling him in 2021, where he's now the staunch superstar? He's just an incredible athlete in his own right. But how did you feel? Did you feel that you were up to his level to wrestle him, or did you feel the difference between you wrestling the first time to now?
I think like for both of us, like again, like it's tougher because again, like when we were doing the tapings, we were taped at like all kind of hours of the day, so it's kind of like it's not a show per se. You know, I mean, it's just a different type of way to produce wrestling. So it's obviously different in that environment. But I think like both Jason and me are totally different people. Like you say, he's now like the staunch superstar with everything with the Rangers and thing and all that. Like it's just a totally different Jason Reed. And I would like to think from Luke Kyro is totally different to Benedict Thatcher. So, so I was just, it's like this familiarity there, but obviously the environment we're in, we were completely different at the time. And obviously there was different stories to tell, because both the matches I had with Jason were kind of like story driven, because he had stuff going on with them both times with BT Gunn. So it was cool that there was more of a, you know, for like ICW, there was those kind of arcs we could build and play on.
I'm just thinking of that now. Yeah, back in wherever it was, it would have been Benedict Thatcher against, I think, was he still doing Nando's and Chill, Netflix and Chill, and
yeah.
Jason Reed and Chill, and the Nando's, Cheeky Nando's, and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, to go back and revisit that to 2021, it's definitely a quite a bit around. Different. another opponent that pops up in this list is Andy Wilde. Because it's Andy Wilde. It's just the size of the man. And the fact that he could still do all these things he could when he was about half the weight he is now is just astonishing. As far as testing goes, I mean, of course, Andy Wilde, he heads FPWA. Have you been able did you go to a bit of FPWA? Did you do online stuff or anything like that while you were trying to stay sane during this pandemic?
I think, yeah, like he had like stuff on, like, you know, like, yeah, Andy's obviously so good with everything he's built up with FPWA. You know, do you think that he started that in 2019? You know, how he's built this group of guys and girls that are like, do you know what I mean? Like, he's got a lot of people there that are just ready to like break through and come through. But I can remember being on a few like Facebook things he had. I remember like calls and stuff he'd done, and obviously just keeping on top of that. I've never actually been to the FPW Asylum, so it'd be cool to see it. But yeah, not totally.
Yeah. So yeah, what was it like in the ring with Andy then? What was it like in the ring with him?
It's like at the end, like, it's obviously he's on the list of, I'm not got a list of people I want to wrestle, but he's like, he's one of the guys in Scotland that you want to get in the ring with and test yourself against and see how he performs. I think it was like, again, being in the ring with him was, it was so intense, and I've never felt like that in a match before, like how alert he was and how like just positioning and everything and you know, being a ring general. I got that from Andy Wilde a lot. Again, in a different environment, obviously, but it'd be cool to run that back in front of a crowd, and obviously I'm slightly different now than I was even then, so it'd be cool to tell a different story. But yeah, it's you work out quickly, you know, the levels to this and where Andy's at when you're in the ring with him, and it's just an experience.
So we're speaking of you being different then, of course, because your first kind of proper get your teeth into a story was the Vibes. A little bit of a talk show segment, which is a big ask for anyone to do, to do a talk show segment in front of a, or was it in front of a crowd when you started doing that, or was that in front of me?
Yeah.
So, and then it led to you teaming with Adam Maxted of course, Love Island fame. However many matches he does, that's always going to be his big thing. Yeah. That and Five Star Wrestling, former Five Star Wrestling tag team champion. I don't forget Five Star Wrestling. definitely a very... When you look at it on the surface, a very odd pairing, because of course Adam Maxted is a humongous giant of a dude, and you're in great shape yourself, but when you see them together, it's a bit different. What was it like being linked up with Adam? Of course, someone who's got another guy who's got such a wealth of experience.
Yeah, no, totally. You know, somebody you're aware of and like, you know, the British European wrestling scene, Adam Maxted. So it's cool to work with him. I mean, a really great guy. So like to have that story with the KOE going into Fear and Loathing. And Adam was always really like, helpful and everything like he's seen for it in the visions. And then, really good in the ring. So it's great to always be in and pick up pointers from somebody. And I think Adam Maxted was key, obviously, because the first taping I've ever done, so with ICW, a close set, was against Eddie Castle. And when I came back, it was Jester and Mark Dallas that were kind of like, I kind of see you as kind of like this, you know, summer vibes, kind of. That wasn't the words used, but, you know, like, kind of Love Island-y. That was the thing we kept on playing with. So, you know, bought the initial shirts and concepts. So it would kind of been working in the background the whole time. And then, I think the original concept was we were going to get, like, you know, in Love Island and, like, these reality shows, they have, like, diary rooms and they have, like, you know, like, the booths and stuff where they do, like, their interviews, as if we would, like, present this character, like, in a backstage interview sense for this. And I think then that morphed into, like, you know, how would you feel about getting a talk show? And it was like, yeah, I'd love to get a talk show. And then trying to, you know, put the ideas together of how the visuals and, you know, everything I would say on it. But I think a key part of the inspiration behind it all is Adam Maxted. Not like by design, but obviously to get it over and to get established for what it is. You know, Adam's obviously, he's a good starting point for that.
Absolutely, yeah. So, especially if you're going for the Love Island vibe, best get someone who's been there and
done. Actually been on it.
Get the, like, legitimacy over. But yeah, Fear and Loathing then. I don't know if you ended up wrestling for the live crowds before this point, but what was it like being on Fear and Loathing? Because this is a famed event. It was number 13. It was night number 2 15, of yeah. 13. What was it like going from someone who started their Scottish wrestling stuff with the Fight Club documentary to now wrestling on Fear and Loathing itself? Mm. What was it like?
Yeah, it's crazy. Like, I went to Fear and Loathing 10 in the Hydro, and just, you know, the whole thing of, like, biggest ICW's biggest event of the year. I'd love to be on Fear and Loathing at some point. And then, you know, 3 years later, well, no, 4, counting the missing year. And again, I love tag team wrestling. Obviously, I've been in tag teams before. So, in the KOE are like, you know, I mean, brothers that have that much talent between them, and their look and their moves and their gear, and, like, I mean, the different way they talk, and I think the KOE are, like, really underrated, and where they can go. Not that they need me putting them over like that, but, like, it'll be fine. But, like, obviously, to be in the ring with them as well, I'm really proud of that match. The ending, it didn't go, like, to plan the way we wanted to, but, like, the whole moment of being in the Barrowlands, which is just, again, an iconic venue in Glasgow, and being an ICW's flagship show, amazing.
It's just amazing to see your, like I say, your trajectory from how you started to now you're, like, say, on Fear and Loathing, and you're wrestling on WWE Network and all that kind of stuff. And it's just a really cool thing to watch and go through while we're talking about it here. Other opponents I was pointing out is like LJ Cleary. That must have been pretty cool to go in again. Another one is young, very experienced. But then your next big story was the Manifesto. So before we really get into the Manifesto stuff, I want to speak about combat. It's community pro wrestling. Because you made your debut there with LJ Cleary, Danny Cross, and Talon Jr. Because I hear the reputation of the Fairfield Club. Mm. I've seen it on a source YouTube, a couple of their shows on YouTube. What was it like going into Fairfield Club and Govan to wrestle? Because it sounds just nuts.
I was like, again, I think that was my first family show back, family crowd back. Mm-hmm. And it's not like any family crowd per se, but yeah. Mental, like everything, like just the noise in the place. And again, when I went in, because again, I've seen it as well, like I've seen it in videos before, but it's so much, it feels a lot bigger than what I thought it would have. And again, Davey sold the place out, and it was like just kids going mental. So that's a different kind of experience. I don't even know if I class that as family, just Govan.
When you said your first family show, I was like, I've seen the shows. I don't think that's family at all.
I don't think either.
it's sugar and adrenaline and just swearing. And it's all kids, which is the still more terrifying thing of it all. It's just so I just wanted to take a wee sidebar there, because I'm always intrigued by anyone who wrestles in Govan, because it's just it looks like an experience to go through. Other points you had, obviously one of my favorites, Caleb Valhalla. You ended up beating him.
I love
that man far too much. Then we got the Manifesto. That's where we're at now. Right, before we actually get to that, we've got some questions about vibes, so that's probably a good place to go, because we're talking about vibes. The guys at We Talk Show, they've mm-hmm. asked, who's got the best vibes in the locker room?
Who's got the best vibes in the locker room? I mean, I'm not going to say myself, obviously being the host of the vibes, but I'd probably go Jack Jester, because again, like, I wear my shirts and I wear all these kind of loud kind of shirts for my show and whatever, but maybe, you know, a more toned down t-shirt, but Jack Jester's style is 24/7, so, I mean, he's always got some good outfit on and some wild things, so they've got to go Jack Jester with the best vibes.
Great, yeah, great. Then we've got Westy on ICW. You have your own show called Vibes, as we know. If you were given your own Vibes reality show outside of wrestling, who'd be your ideal first guest?
I've got loads I could think of for wrestling. Who would I want on Vibes? But outside of wrestling, God, I don't know. I would say, do you know what I'd say? It's a bit of a random one, but my favorite musician is probably Miley Cyrus, and I think again she's just like off the scale. Like in her covers and everything she does in her style again. So I think it would be a bit of a messy interview. But I'd like to see where Miley Cyrus's head was at. But Miley Cyrus.
I'm sure my age, because when we said Miley Cyrus, I was like, oh yeah, of course, Hannah Montana. Hold down, throw down, all that kind of stuff. And then realizing, no, that's not Miley Cyrus
it's
now. She is not doing... She's not the best of both worlds anymore. She's a bit more grungier than that.
Not at all.
No, that sounds...
Either her or my mum. That's who I'll go. Get my mum
That's what you do for your first guest. That's the best one. Go for your mum.
I don't think the world's ready for it.
Speaking of that, of course, we started wrestling, you were very young. Were your parents very much supportive of helping you? Or was there kind of... Do you think it was just going to be a phase?
No, I think they know how much I like WWE, and it's always on. I'm always watching it. You know, they just know how much it's been my thing. And I think initially, like, you know, the usual mom was probably a bit hesitant with like the physicality of it and injuries and stuff. But I think she's gotten used to it, and they've always encouraged me and pushed me on to do it, which I'm very like fortunate for, because I know there's a lot of people that they don't have that support. Which obviously I think, you know, if you're passionate enough, you power through, but it definitely makes it easier to have that support network to fall back on. Because again, you know, you have those moments of self-doubt or whatever, and you've always got somebody, you know, there. It's always helpful. It's always been appreciated.
So yeah, finally getting onto the manifesto stuff. So this has been the big storyline for at least your 2022. With ADM, Dylan Thorne, Eddie Castle, and of course Grant McIver. Which led to Super Smoking Thunderbolt Bar 2. So a little bit, it's kind of war. It's war games ish.
Yes, war games.
War games, but with a ICW twist to it. What was that like? Because that's eventually eight guys in a very small ring in comparison to. I don't know if they've got a 20-foot ring or a 16. I don't know. I don't measure these things. But even then, it's still eight guys in a very small space.
Yeah.
How did you kind of prepare for that? Did you watch stuff like War Games matches? Did you watch anything? Or I suppose that TNA was probably a bit closer when they did the Lethal Lockdown. Was there anything that kind of you need to check out to try and get a hold of what you want to do in that match?
I think, like, initially, that you say, like, when I had obviously known that I was going to be in it, like, yeah, you do look back at, like, steel cage matches of any kind and how people, you know, tell their story in a steel cage, because obviously like, there's that initial excitement as if, oh, I'm going to have a steel cage match. But obviously, like you say, logistically, like, there's eight of us, and I think the ring was 18 foot, you know. When other companies do it, they have two rings, and it's a bit bigger or whatever, like you say. So we're obviously... Everybody's consciously aware that there's not a lot of room, so it's kind of working around that. But yeah, it was just like excitement going into Bard, because again, like I said, I've always liked multi-man matches and the garage and just like the whole thing, and it's the main event as well. Like it was a really cool story.
Of course, you're teaming with Jester as well, guy that you met on would have met on your first day, and again. We're going back to that insane Fight Club would have been a guy that you were first introduced to. That. So it's the fact that you were teaming with them on the main event of a show. Sounds like it was mind-blowing at the same time.
Totally. You go, like, you don't know what situations you'll find yourself in or what will happen to anybody, and you don't know where you'll be a year from now or whatever. So, yeah, totally, like, it's just really proud of that match and the team and part of it, because it only aired, obviously, not that long ago. But yeah, I think it came across really well.
And then looking to the future then, before we look to the future of Luke Kyro, we've got our ridiculous questions we ask everyone. I don't know if you're aware of past episodes.
Then, yeah.
Good. I'm glad to hear it. So the first one we ask everyone is, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Pterodactyl. I had that answer for this.
I know, that's the quickest I've had that answered in a while. And the other one we ask is, what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Oh, I should have prepared for this one. Two sheep or one cow, right. Nah, you've got to go the cow. Like, I think in my head, I'm trying to, like, think of ways the sheep could win there, but no, the cow would win.
I'm really
unless the sheep are mental, but I still can't see it.
I'm really going to have to try and find a way to splice, because there's a video on YouTube that has a sheep versus a cow, and the results will surprise you. So the fact that it's two sheep,
no.
I'm just saying. But yeah, it's an incredible question that I don't get fed up asking. Since I think it was a Luke King Sharp episode, I think that's when it started. It was like way back in, I don't know, episode 30, maybe something like that. And everyone's got a reason. They always think, right, you always think it's a silly question, and then they always come back with, oh, I think it'll be this because, like, great.
There's a justification.
I like there's a justification for your answer for a stupid question like that. So looking into the future then, for Luke Kyro, of course, you're now settled quite nicely in ICW. That seems to be your home brand, your home promotion. Of course, you do stuff at Community Pro Wrestling.
Yeah.
I will remember to call them that and not Combat League, because that's the opposite side of the country. A little bit, yeah. So where's your aspirations? Is there any companies that you're wanting to try and get to, say, in the next, I don't know, 12 months or so? Is there any companies that you want to try and get wrestling in?
Yeah, definitely. I think, like, getting out there is obviously important. Really happy with where I'm at with ICW and obviously with Davies Community Pro Wrestling. I think that'll be a lot of good shows coming up there throughout the year, and where he takes that. But other companies as well, like, I'd love to wrestle at Reckless Intent. I think just because, like, I stay in Livingston, it's like the Scout Hall is like their home venue. It's really close to me. Like, I had a birthday party there when I was like 5, so it's like, it's just, you know, and there's a lot of people there obviously I'm familiar with, so it'd be cool to work for Reckless, as well as, like, Discovery. You know, I've been to a couple of Discovery shows, obviously just watching in the crowd, but yeah, I really like, again, a professional company that's got a great roster through there in Edinburgh, so yeah, I'd like to go Discovery, Reckless, and probably up your way as well, WrestleZone. Obviously, you know, they've had a lot of big shows this year, and they've got a complete brand of their own, and, you know, a lot of guys there that are, you know, I'd like to work in. Well, I like to work with loads of people, obviously, but, you know, these companies that seem to have their own niches and their own complete new set of roster would be cool to get in the mixer, but we'll see.
I'm glad I said that. I needed. And anyone who mentions them on the podcast automatically, like, becomes a favorite wrestler of mine, because I'm obsessed with that company so much. It's insane. It's ridiculous at this point. Before we kind of finish up and do a little bit more fantasy booking,
yeah,
I didn't mention, of course, in Community Pro Wrestling, you're part of the Handsome Man Club with the Sam Barber Experience and Levi. Mm-hmm. Again, it's tag team. You love tag team wrestling. It's very much, very obvious, very evident on how you've operated your career so far. You love a bit of tag team wrestling. But yeah. So what's it like just being part of the Handsome Man's Club? Is it something a bit different for you? Able to kind of change up Luke Kyro a little bit to accommodate it? What's your kind of
vibe? Again, it's just, like you say, it's totally, in Community Pro Wrestling is obviously different to ICW, so it's just that chance to do something a bit different. Yeah, we'll see where it goes. Like, and what that looks like in Govan. But yeah, to also Sam and Levi coming for GPWA, you know, two guys I'm familiar with. So yeah, it's good to always dip your toes in new things, I suppose, and, you know, try something else.
And as far as dream opponents go, you said there's everyone you want to wrestle. Is there anyone in particular? Again, next 12 months, if you had the chance to get in the ring with, you'd jump at it.
God, I think like one match I've always wanted to have is BT Gunn. And I know I hate saying that because obviously he's GPRA coach, it comes across like a bias, but obviously he's like one of the top names in Scotland. So I'd love to, whenever the situation's right, to work with BT Gunn and his style and, you know, his intricacies and his matches and stuff. So it'd be good to mix up with him. But yeah, I think he's always one that I've always wanted to have. In a realistic way. I don't know, like dream opponents like that probably aren't going to happen. But yeah, BT Gunn's the most realistic one. That's what.
Fine. I think I know the answer to our final question though. Before we do the social media stuff, is right. This is the new last question for this particular season. It's Vince McMahon phones you. He's giving you the main event at WrestleMania. He said, right, I've seen you on WWE Network. I'm impressed. I want you in the main event at WrestleMania. You get to choose your opponent, the match stipulation. So opponents, could be a multi-man match. You get to choose match stipulation. What is it?
Oof. Dream scenario.
My only kind of stipulation is they have to be alive.
Yeah,
I'll
have
to go. Active or inactive, whatever you want, alive is my only.
That's my only limitation. Yeah, so what I'm, again, it seems like if it's WrestleMania, it's got to be Mr. WrestleMania. It would have to be Shawn Michaels. I think he's had you look at people's back catalogue of WrestleMania matches, I just think probably has the Undertaker's probably stand up the most, but obviously Shawn Michaels is my favourite. As far as match stipulation goes, God, I don't know. Part of me is like just straight up one-on-one, but I think if you like play on Shawn Michaels, I think you've got to go ladder. Like I just feel like you've got to... All right, so a singles ladder versus Shawn Michaels, and that's what the dream scenario would be.
There you go. That's a nice easy one. I knew it as soon as I started asking it, we spoke about Shawn Michaels, I knew it was going to be him somewhere, whether it was going to be you and someone against DX or something was going to be there somewhere. But no, that's it. I think that's the thing we've covered. I could probably speak to you for hours about nothing, but so I think we'll kind of wrap it up at this point. While the internet still is working, where can people find out more about Luke Kyro?
So yeah, I'm on my Facebook is at Luke Kyro LK, and then my Twitter and Instagram is at Luke_Kyro. So I just post about everything I've got upcoming, whether that be to ICW or anything else new, and just all my clips, everything I've got going on, I post to those socials.
Perfect. Well, great. Well, thank you very much for speaking to me today. This has been an absolute blast.
Thanks. It's been good to finally get to talk to you and meet you in person after reading the Scottish Wrestling Network for years and the news reports coming in. So, I'm really happy to have done this. So, thanks.
Oh, shucks.